Soon, Aisha is barely going out. She sits in Taslima's room and stares out the window. Her hair looks greasy. She hasn't even bothered to press coconut oil into her scalp or run her fingers through the kinks. She keeps wearing that stupid Destiny's Child t-shirt, and when no one's home, she sneaks into the living room and watches soaps on TV. She goes to school, but it's like she's hardly there. I don't know if she shows up for her after-school stuff. And I'm tired of the lies, to Mr. Friedlander, to her friends, to our parents. Every day is a piece of rubber stretched so tight it's going to snap. Aisha's gang tries to find out what's happening, but Aisha starts avoiding them. At lunch, she gulps down her food and then leaves, says she has to go study. What is going on? Risa asks us once after school. I tried calling you the other day, and the number didn't work. I've been busy, Aisha replies and starts walking down the steps. Aisha, Kavita calls out, what about Saturday? It's the citywide debate team finals, and all the participating schools will be at the Marriott in Manhattan. Aisha keeps walking, her elbows pressed at her sides. The next morning, Aisha wakes up late and stays in bed. She doesn't even try to get dressed to go on the subway to Manhattan for the citywide rounds. Around midday, she rouses herself, a blanket wrapped around her. You have a cold? Auntie keeps asking. Aisha shakes her head. She shuffles back into Taslima's bedroom, shutting the door softly. A few times, I think I hear the sound of her crying. That night, Aisha and I sleep hunched against one another. I can sense her fright, her cold heels bumping against mine. Go to sleep, I tell her over and over, but I know she can't. Taslima starts to slip away too. More and more, she stays out late and doesn't even apologize when she sneaks back in, shoes in her hand. Auntie begs her, please tell me where you are going all these crazy hours. Taslima pushes her fist into her leather jacket. Ma, you know where. We've got work to do. The protest? Your father, if he knew. My father's in jail. Why do you think I'm doing this? But to go out on the streets, so brazen-like? Emma. Taslima's grabbed Auntie by both arms, and she's holding her, shaking her firmly as if Auntie is the child and she's the stern grown-up. Emma, this is what they want, for us to be afraid. That evening, Taslima pulls me into her bedroom. She's all hollows and scooped out shadows. A blue bead strung on a silver wire gleams against her thin neck. She's cut her hair even shorter, so it sticks up from her scalp like thin black needles. I know Abba would be upset, she whispers, but I can't do it. I can't pretend like everything's normal. She clutches my hand. Promise me, Nadira, that you won't let Ma know I'm not going to classes. But what if you get kicked out? She looks at me, hard. I could get thrown out of this country any day now. She turns away, chewing on her lip as if she already has another life elsewhere. It scares me, what Taslima is doing. Taking her anger outside for all the world to see, like turning open our skins raw and ugly. And me? I don't know what to do with myself anymore. I can't figure out how to get us through this, to pick up the thread of working together, to continue our fight. None of it seems possible. Sometimes I'll pull out the file and look at all Aisha and I did, and it feels silly, like a pretend social studies exercise. A baby thing. I stop helping Ali Uncle at the shop, telling him I have too much homework. I duck out of school through a different door so Lily won't find me. I feel guilty, but I just need to be alone, not with her or my sister or anybody.